Wailing Well by M.R. James, narrated by Peter Coates. In the year 1900 and such and such, there were two members of the troop of scouts attached to a famous school, named respectively Arthur Wilcox and Stanley Judkins. They were the same age, boarded in the same house, were in the same division, and naturally were members of the same patrol. They were so much alike in appearance as to cause anxiety and trouble, and even irritation to the masters who came in contact with them. But oh, how different they were in their inward man, or boy. It was to Arthur Wilcox that the headmaster said, looking up with a smile as the boy entered chambers, "Why, Wilcox, there will be a deficit in the prize fund if you stay here much longer. Here, take this handsomely bound copy of The Life and Works of Bishop Ken, and with it my hearty congratulations to yourself and your excellent parents." It was Wilcox again whom the provost noticed as he passed through the playing fields, and pausing for a moment, observed to the vice-provost, "That lad has a remarkable brow." "Indeed, yes," said the vice-provost. "It denotes either genius or water on the brain." As a scout, Wilcox secured every badge and distinction for which he competed. The cookery badge, the map-making badge, the life-saving badge, the badge for picking up bits of newspaper, the badge for not slamming the door when leaving pupil room, and many others. Of the life-saving badge, I may have a word to say when we come to treat of Stanley Judkins. You cannot be surprised to hear that Mr. Hope Jones added a special verse to each of his songs, in commendation of Arthur Wilcox, or that the lower master burst into tears when handing him the Good Conduct Medal in its handsome claret-coloured case. The medal, which had been unanimously voted to him by the whole of Third Form. Unanimously, did I say? I am wrong. There was one dissentient, Judkins Minor, who said that he had excellent reasons for acting as he did. He shared, it seems, a room with his major. You cannot again wonder that in after years Arthur Wilcox was the first, and so far the only boy, to become captain of both the school and of the oppidans, or that the strain of carrying out the duties of both positions, coupled with the ordinary work of the school, was so severe that a complete rest for 6 months, followed by a voyage round the world, was pronounced an absolute necessity by the family doctor. It would be a pleasant task to trace the steps by which he attained the giddy eminence he now occupies, but for the moment, enough of Arthur Wilcox. Time presses, and we must turn to a very different matter, the career of Stanley Judkins, Judkins Major. Stanley Judkins, like Arthur Wilcox, attracted the attention of the authorities, but in quite another fashion. It was to him that the lower master said, with no cheerful smile, "What, again, Judkins? Very little persistence in this course of conduct, my boy, and you will have cause to regret that you ever entered this academy. There, take that, and that, and think yourself very lucky you don't get that, and that." It was Judkins again, whom the provost had cause to notice as he passed through the playing fields, when a cricket ball struck him with considerable force on the ankle, and a voice from a short way off cried, "Thank you, cut over." "I think," said the provost, pausing for a moment to rub his ankle, "that that boy had better fetch his cricket ball for himself." "Indeed, yes," said the vice provost, "and if he comes within reach, I will do my best to fetch him something else." As a scout, Stanley Judkins secured no badge save those which he was able to abstract from members of other patrols. In the cookery competition, he was detected trying to introduce squibs into the Dutch oven of the next-door competitors. In the tailoring competition, he succeeded in sewing two boys together very firmly, with disastrous effect when they tried to get up. For the tidiness badge, he was disqualified because, in the midsummer school time, which chanced to be hot, he could not be dissuaded from sitting with his fingers in the ink, as he said, "for coolness's sake." For one piece of paper which he picked up, he must have dropped at least 6 banana skins or orange peels. Aged women, seeing him approaching, would beg him with tears in their eyes not to carry their pails of water across the road. They knew too well what the result would inevitably be. But it was in the life-saving competition that Stanley Judkins's conduct was most blamable and had the most far-reaching effects. The practice, as you know, was to throw a selected lower boy, of suitable dimensions, fully dressed, with his hands and feet tied together, into the deepest part of Cuckoo Weir, and to time the scout whose turn it was to rescue him, on every occasion when he was entered for this.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.